In this challenge problem, we're computing the work done by gravity as this simple pendulum bob descends through a height of h. Now, if you know about conservation of energy already, then you know there's a workaround to this that makes it so we don't have to use any calculus. And that's the whole point of energy methods, is that they simplify your life a lot. But for now, we're trying to do a direct calculation of the work. So I'm going to start to get force vectors in here and say, okay, gravity's doing what gravity always does. It's pulling straight down with a magnitude of mg. So there's my force vector at this moment in time. And then I can look at a small increment of time going by, and I end up moving along this tiny little section of arc that I'll call dr. And then the work increment here, I may as well write that down, and then we have to go back and do some geometry. But the work increment during that small little chunk of time is going to be given by mg dotted into dr. And our goal is to integrate that, add up all the dw's, and find the total work done by gravity on the way down this path. Quick side note. When I set up the work increment, I totally ignored the tension force, just intuitively, but that should be explained. Why am I able to just ignore the tension force? And the answer is that the tension is always pointing exactly perpendicular to the direction of motion, because the direction of motion is tangential and the tension force is pulling radially. And this is actually not just a special case, but it's a general truth about forces of constraint. So forces of constraint that means a force that is used purely to keep an object on a particular path. So the force of constraint that we use most often is a normal force. That's what it's doing. It's keeping an object in contact with the surface, and normal forces are also perpendicular to displacement, so they do no work. So tension does no work here. And that's why we're allowed to ignore it. So first off, if I'm going to get this dot product, I need to find the angle right here. I'll call it phi. And I'm going to take advantage of the fact that this angle is theta, the same as this angle of incline of the pendulum. So it looks like theta and phi must add up to 90 degrees. So I could say that phi is 90 minus theta. And we'll just save that over here for when it comes in handy. All right, then I have another piece that I need to figure out. I need to express h in terms of L and theta. My ultimate goal here is to be able to write down an integral that's entirely phrased in terms of theta. So I'm working on it. So this height right here, that's also L. This, by the way, is a really common geometry step that has to be taken in calculus-based physics. And this little chunk right here, well, that's a leg of a right triangle with a hypotenuse of L happening over here. So that's going to be a L cosine theta. It's a cosine because it's the adjacent side. And that means I just figured out that H plus L cosine theta is equal to L. In other words, H is L minus L cosine theta, which I might want to clean up a little bit. And then I'll put that in a box. L times the quantity 1 minus cosine theta. So let's see. Maybe I'll get back to working on dw. That's going to be mg dotted into a little dr which gives me mg times the magnitude of dr times the cosine of the angle between them, which would be the cosine of 90 minus theta. I see one more little piece of prep work that has to be done. I need to get the magnitude of dr. And this is a little section of arc on a circle. And we have a formula. I'm going to call that little angle d theta. We have a formula for writing down the arc length in terms of the radius and the angle subtended. It's just s equals r theta, or arc length is equal to radius times the angle. So I have just a little side note here. I'll just put it over here in green. That little dr's magnitude is going to be L times d theta. I just use the formula s equals r theta there. Let's get that into our dw. So I have mg times L, and I'll put the d theta at the end. And then the cosine of 90 minus theta, there's an identity for that. That's the sine of theta. And then a little d theta at the end. This stuff out in front is just constants, so that's not a problem. And then this stuff is all phrased in terms of theta, so it's starting to look like we can set up the integral. My final value of theta is going to be 0 when I'm down here. My initial value of theta, I may want to express that in terms of other quantities. So let's write down the work integral. I'll just leave it like this for now because we have to work on these limits of integration. MgL sine theta d theta. All right. So my initial angle, I suppose that I could write it in terms of other quantities. Maybe what I should do is take this expression and solve for theta. That's my initial angle. I didn't need to solve for that height at all. In a lot of problems you do, so I just kind of did it reflexively. So if I go back to this top formula, I get h minus l is negative l cosine theta. If I then divide by negative l, it reverses the order on the left-hand side because of the minus sign, and I end up with a 1. Minus h over l equals cosine theta, which means my initial value of theta is going to be the angle whose cosine is 1 minus h over l. Let's plug that into our work integral. And I have an initial theta of inverse cosine 1 minus h over l, and a final theta of 0, and an integrand of mgl sine theta d theta. But there's one more trick lurking in this integral before we can just put on our calculus hats and evaluate it. And the issue is that d theta is actually negative here. So if I look at what's happening in this process, theta is getting smaller. That means my little d theta counts as a negative number, and that causes a sign error in the integral. So the work done by gravity, even this little work contribution done by gravity, it must be a positive number because I can see that the angle between the force of gravity and the little displacement is less than 90 degrees. But d theta is a negative number. So how are we going to fix it? We just throw in a minus sign to correct the problem. Now I can finally get to integrating this thing. And I'm just going to pull the constants out in front. And then I have to guess the antiderivative. Oops, I forgot a theta in there. I have to guess the antiderivative of the sine function, and that's just negative cosine. And those minus signs will cancel out. And then I need to evaluate this from the angle whose cosine is 1 minus h over l all the way to 0. And when I plug in 0, the cosine of 0 is 1, so my first term is going to be mgl, and then I'll have minus the thing that I get when I plug in the lower limit. So that's going to be mgl cosine of the angle whose cosine, oh, those undo each other, So the cosine of the angle whose cosine is this thing is just that thing. And I distribute this. And something nice happens to the first term. I have an MGL, but when I distribute the minus sign to it, I end up with MGL minus an MGL. So those are gone. And then I have only one survivor. I have negative MGL multiplied by negative H over L. And the L's cancel. And I find out that the work done by gravity is just MGH. Now, we're going to develop a theory of energy that allows us to bypass all this integration stuff. And with a bit of experience, you could just look at the problem right from the beginning and say, oh, it descended through a height of h. I know the work of gravity is going to be MGH regardless of the path.